in PP collisions at LHC energy, we found collective-like behavior in high multiplicity proton-proton collisions and proton-lead collisions. And now the question that we want to answer, I mean, we, the community, is what is the origin of those effects? Whether it is, they are connected with the formation of the quark-gluon plasma in small systems, or any other mechanism is playing a role for the formation of the observed phenomena. I also mentioned yesterday that event generators, for example, like Pythia, now Herwig, as far as I know, they are able to describe many some aspects of the new phenomenon in PP, and in the case of Pythia, they are working also in some implementation for proton-lead collisions. So the focus of the talk today is the way in which the experiment can use Monte Carlo in order to build event classifiers which allow us to understand better the origin of the effect. So as I said, we found striking similarities when we compare several observables at both RICAT and at LHC energy. Okay, for example, when we compare the PT spectra of different particle species, and if we study the evolution as a function of multiplicity, we found a lot of similarities between PP and AA collisions. As I said, besides the hydrodynamic description, there are other calculations, for example, from the considering transport model, hadronic rescattering, as well as initial state effects, which can reproduce some aspect of the data. In particular, at least the topic in which I have worked during the last year, is related with the connection of our observation with multiparton interaction. Because as you know now in Pythia, if they incorporate additional mechanisms like stream ropes or shoving, they can actually explain for example, the hyperon to pion ratio, no? At least better than before. In addition, I also discussed that event generators like Pythia with the option of color reconnection, one observed collective like effect in high multiplicity PP collision. In this second bullet, I just want to bring to your attention to the fact that even people who are well known in the heavy ion community, the theories from the heavy ions, they are now also looking at the QCD theory of multiparton interactions. For example, in this paper, Urs Wiedemann and Strickman have shown that using, let's say, the QCD theory of MPI, considering QCD interference, they have produced values of VN2, VN4, where N is even, that persist even at very high in events with very high number of MPIs. So this is just to tell you that this kind of processes are attracting the attention of our community, the heavy ion community, and of course, no, the connection with the in order to try to understand the origin of the new phenomena in high multiplicity PP collision. Okay, from the experimental point of view, there are some issues. One of those is related with selection bias. The problem is that if we measure both the multiplicity and the PT spectra within the same pseudorapidity range, then we observe this kind of effects. In this figure in the left, you can see the PT spectra of charged particles, okay, final charged particles, going from blue to red, we have low number of particles produced in the collision, and in red events with a larger number of final charged particles. Okay, this is the event multiplicity. In this case, the multiplicity and the PT spectra are measured at mid-pseudo rapidity. In the case of the ALICE experiment, in this particular paper, the pseudo rapidity which is considered is plus minus 0.8. Okay, we observe an evolution of the PT distribution, not only at low PT. Okay, in order to characterize the evolution of the spectral shape as a function of the event multiplicity, we proceed, no, as in previous analysis results that I have shown yesterday, we can plot the ratio of the different spectra measuring different multiplicity classes, the ratio to minimum bias for inner PP collision. And this, of course, as a function of PT. And what we observe is that going from blue to red, okay, at low PT, for PT below 0.7 GV over C, we see an increase, no? At low PT, this is something that we understand because we are, let's say, triggering on multiplicity. Therefore, if we require more particles at middle rapidity, we expect to see this change if we compare with the minimum bias PT case. Okay, however, at high PT, okay, for PT bigger than 1 GV, we observe a fast increase of the ratio with respect to minimum bias. This means, of course, that the production of high PT particles is bigger in events with a large activity at middle rapidity. This is an issue in particular if you want to extract, for example, jet quenching effects from the high multiplicity PP data. One alternative which has been explored is related with the measurement of the PT spectra, of course, at middle rapidity in plus minus 0.8, and selecting or doing the measurement of the multiplicity in the forward region, considering, for example, the activity registered in the detector, no? That is called V0. So we measure the multiplicity in the forward region, okay? We do the event classification, and then we perform the measurement of the PT distribution that meets pseudo rapidity. The idea is to see whether with this kind of analysis, one can reduce the bias. However, if we consider the selection based on the V0 detector, we still observe an increasing rise of the ratio at high PT. So this illustrates the correlation between the inclusive multiplicity, okay, which is sensitive to low PT particle production, okay. So there is a correlation between inclusive multiplicity and the high PT particle production. And this, as I said, is an issue, no, if we want to study effects in events in which a jet is produced, okay, in order to extract jet quenching effects from PP collision. This is an alternative view of the particle production at high PT. In this case, what Alice reported in this paper is the particle production in different intervals of PT, the average production as a function of the event multiplicity. And again, we see that going from 2 to 4 GV up to 6 to 10 GV, the rise of the production, okay, increases, let's say, faster. With multiplicity, we consider only high PT particles. In ALICE, people started to look at observables which in heavy ion collisions are traditionally used in order to extract jet quenching effects. Yesterday, I mentioned that in PP collisions, we have observed everything except jet quenching. We still have not seen the signature of the parton energy loss, no, in high multiplicity PP collision. in these proceedings of the ALICE collaboration, it has been reported that the data in which has been selected at high multiplicity, in which we have a jet, no, and the idea is to study the recoil jet. Okay, it has been observed that the distribution more or less follow the behavior which can be attributed to the presence of jet quenching in proton-proton collision. The big problem is that this effect appear both in data and also in Monte Carlo simulations of Uspitia. So the idea is that the selection bias could produce or could mimic signatures, let's say, of jet quenching, no, in the small systems. So therefore, it's now important to develop new strategies in order to control or understand better the selection bias. No? Because if we, in the small systems, in proton-proton collisions, if we select a large number of particles in a very restricted acceptance, then we bias our sample toward harder proton-proton collision. One attempt in order to understand the bias and the impact on the data has also been proposed by the CMS Atlas and the ALICE collaboration, and this is related with the use of event shapes. Okay. Event shapes, for example, help us to classify the high multiplicity proton-proton collisions. This is an example of, let's say, event display in eta and phi for two high multiplicity proton-proton collisions simulated with Pitya. Okay. The definition of transverse spherocity is given by this ratio, where the idea is to minimize this ratio. And for that, one has to find a unit vector which minimizes this ratio. Of course, if you have a jet-like structure, you expect that the momentum which is perpendicular to the spherocity axis will be quite small, no? In the limit of a pencil-like structure, or in a high multiplicity VP collision, if we have a jet-like structure, right? So the idea is that with these observables, one can classify the collisions as either jet-like, those having spherocity very close to zero, and isotropic. Okay, in the isotropic case, we expect that the value of this quantity, spherocity, approach to unity. Okay, so in these figures, you can see two high multiplicity proton-proton collisions, one with 42 charged particles and the other with 44. No, the multiplicity is very, very similar. However, in the left-hand side, the spherocity is very small, 0.09, and in the right-hand side, the spherocity is 0.96. Okay. And you see that in the transverse plane, no, if we look at the azimuthal angle, you see this diet-like structure, right? You see these two maximum, one which would correspond to the near side and the other to the associated to the wayside jet. On the other hand, if we consider the most isotropic events, you see that the particles are distributed, no, in the full azimuth. So these are two different types of event structure that one can analyze. Okay, so the idea is, for example, to data, no, to select high multiplicity proton-proton collisions and then try to isolate, no, or discard those in which we know that at least a jet structure is present. In this figure, you see just an illustration on how spherocity works. In this axis is the same multiplicity going from from bottom to the upper part, this multiplicity increase, and going from left to right, the value of transverse serosity increases. Okay, at low multiplicity, most of the events, no, are expected to have a low value of serosity. However, what is interesting for us are the events which are which have a large multiplicity, and this is an illustration. Even if you have more or less particles distributed in an isotropic way, you know, in the azimuth, just the presence of a high PT particle makes that the average transverse ferocity move to lower, slightly lower values of transverse ferocity. It's very hard to reach the isotropic limit. Okay, the isotropic limit means that there are no hard, let's say, jets produced in the collision. And one of the motivations of doing this analysis in proton-proton data is exactly the isolation of those events with a very large spherocity close to zero, where no jet diejet structures are present. Okay. So the first results using this quantity were also motivated by some simulations, no, which were performed in PCA. For example, in this figure, you see the distribution of the number of multipartum interactions, okay, in the left, and on the right, using PCA 6, the Tune Perugia 2011, a factor, no, which is related with the impact parameter. No, at that time in PCA 6, it was this factor was called enhancement factor, no, the EV, no, which was related with the average impact parameter, no, in the sample. What we observe is that in minimum bias proton-proton collision, what is shown here with the empty markers, so this is the distribution of the number of MPIs. If we select events with low spherocity, so the average number of MPIs is small. And if we select event with large spherocity, you see that we can move, no, to those which have a larger number of multipartum interactions, which are also connected, no, with those in which this enhancement factor is bigger, no, is telling us that we applying this kind of selection criterion, we can select, let's say, more central PP collision just by selecting high spherocity. And by selecting low spherocity, we were selecting those in which the number of MPI were smaller, and at the same time, the average of the enhancement factor was smaller with respect to the most isotropic events. So with this in mind, we did the analysis using the ALICE data, PP data, certain TEV. This paper was published in 2019. The first quantity which was measured was the average PT as a function of multiplicity. Normally what we measure is the minimum bias case, right? Which is represented with the empty markers. Okay? We know that the average PT increased with increasing multiplicity, and in PCA this effect is again produced by the presence of color reconnection, no? Multipartum interaction and color reconnection produce this rise of the average PT with multiplicity. But now, for the first time, we also consider an additional selection based on spherocity. We consider the Yeti class consisting in the 0 to 10%, say most of the distribution, which is closer to zero, okay? And then the 90 to 100%, which correspond to the isotropic events. These are percentiles of the distribution. So in this figure, in this small figure, you see the value of spherocity as a function of multiplicity, the 0 to 10%, is represented by the area below the black curve, okay? You see that at low multiplicity, the 10% of the spherocity distribution go from 0 up to 0.05. These are the most yeti quantified in terms of this percentile of the spherocity distribution. And for higher multiplicities, for example, for more than 45 DND eta, we see that the spherocity associated to 0 to 5% goes from 0 up to around 0.5. For the most isotropic events, the yeti-like in low multiplicity goes from 0.55 up to 1, and for high multiplicity goes from 0.8 up to 1. So this is the way in which we classify the different PP collisions. Of course, our goal for the next measurement is to go to the extremes of the yeti-like and isotropic events. By analyzing, for example, the 0 to 1%, no, most yeti, and the 99 to 100%. Okay, but even with these wide intervals, which we are considering in this analysis, we already see some difference between the most yeti events and the most isotropic events. In particular, for the yeti events, we observe that the average PT is higher than in minimum bias. And this is expected, no, given the selection that we are doing. We are selecting harder PP collisions, no, just by implementing this cotton event shape. If we consider now the isotropic events, then we observe a slightly lower average PT than that measured in minimum bias proton-proton collision. Again, it's expected given that we are selecting like the softer PP interaction. So this was the first result using this type of observable with or event classifier, which is aimed at helping us to understand the bias of the multiplicity, no, in particular in those events in which we have a large number of final charged particles. The other interesting aspect is to discuss how well the models describe the data. In this figure, you see a comparison between data, the empty markers for minimum bias, and the predictions by Pythia and hyposelection. Pythia 6 is also considered, but Pythia A corresponds with the latest, let's say, Monash 2013 tune, no, which consider the early LHC data, no, which is able to describe several observables considering charged particles. Okay, this tune describes very well, no, the behavior of the average PT as a function of multiplicity. If we remove color reconnection, as you can see, we don't see this rise of the average PT with multiplicity. It's more or less constant. The same level of agreement is also found if we consider if isotropic events. The ratio shows that at high multiplicity, the three models describe very well, no, the behavior of the average PT. However, in the case of the yeti-like events, it was a surprise to see that hyposelection describes better the behavior of the data. In contrast, the PTIA results, okay, the PTIA prediction, show, let's say, different behavior at high multiplicity. The data for yeti-like events exhibit a constant, let's say, increase as a function of multiplicity. However, in the case of PTIA 8 and PTIA 6, we observe a third rise of the average PT with increasing multiplicity. And this is a bit surprising because we know that PTIA reproduce better the hard physics, no, in data than EPOS. However, one has to keep in mind that we are considering a very wide interval of spherocity, even for the yeti-like events. Therefore, we still have contributions from the underlying event. And I mean, in order to answer this question, to understand the origin of the discrepancy, what one has to do, for example, is to perform a measurement of the PT spectra as a function of multiplicity and sphericity, no? Because in this paper, we only reported the mean PT. Okay, the origin of the third rise of the mean PT, high multiplicity, at least in PCA, is investigated in this slide. In this picture, you can see the PTA 8 prediction, the mean PT as a function of multiplicity, where you clearly see the third rise of the average PT for multiplicities d and d eta bigger than 30. Okay. So what one can do in PCA is to study the contribution from particles which are within different PT intervals. In yellow, the particles with PT between 0.15 and 2 GeV. In green, particles with PT between 2 and 4 GeV. And finally, in red, the charged particles with PT between 4 and 10 GeV. And you see that the third rise is only present if we consider intermediate and high PT charged particles. Okay, and again, this is consistent, no, with the picture that low sphericity allows the selection of harder proton-proton collisions. One can also repeat this exercise or this study considering simulation without color reconnection. Okay, it's true that if we just remove color reconnection, we don't describe the data, the other set of data, no, measure at the LHC, but still it's interesting, no, just to study the effect at high multiplicity. And it seems that, I mean, at least for the DND eta of around 50, we don't see this fast increase of the mean PT with increasing multiplicity. So a good part of this effect can be attributed, no? A good fraction of the effect that we observe here could be attributed to the presence of to color reconnection. So the question now is whether PTA could improve the description of these jetty-like events. No? And for this, of course, it would be very important, no, to provide measurements of the PT spectra in very high multiplicity events. Okay, because yeah, as you see, no, it's surprising, no, that in data for the jetty-like events we see we don't see the third rise. However, in PTA, something else is happening. At least for me, this effect is interesting because, as you know, no, if we select the jetty-like event, we are sensitive to hard physics, and there we are we have a big interest in the potential discovery of jet quenching, no, in very high multiplicity proton-proton collisions. Therefore, it will be very in the future, no, to investigate the origin of the discrepancy between data and the event generator. Okay, more regarding the results that we have produced, I mean the experiments have produced so far, is related with the hydrochemistry as a function of sphericity. These are new results which were presented last year by several people, in particular Adriano, which is actually from Bloom, presented the P2-pi ratio as a function of PT, considering high multiplicity proton-proton collisions. But in this case, he studied high multiplicity event, but isotropic in blue and jetty-like events in red. Okay, and what he observed is, or what we observe is that if we consider isotropic events in which the number of MPIs, we know that is slightly larger than jetty-like events, we see behavior which is very similar again to what we have seen in the previous in my previous presentation, my previous slide, that in, for example, in lead-lead collisions, if we consider the central lead-lead events, then there is an enhancement at intermediate PT, right? And a depletion at lower Tranberg momentum. It seems that if we consider high multiplicity proton-proton collisions and we isolate those events in which the number of MPIs, at least if I think in terms of models like Kitzia or Herwig, if then the MPI activity contribution is more important, and if color reconnection effects are there, then we expect to see this kind of effects. Okay, that is why a PTA 8 with the tuned Monash reproduce the trend that we observe in the data. Okay, the solid line corresponds to the PTA predictions in red for Yeti-like events and in blue for isotropic events. So it seems that if we consider this kind of classification, we can enhance the effects produced by a multiple parton interactions. In addition, we can also do a similar comparison, for example, with EPOS LHC. EPOS LHC implements a different model for the production of low PT particles. It includes the simulation of the core, no? Which is the fraction, let's say, of the matter which would have the, some QGP-like effects. Okay, it is included at least in the EPOS LHC via a parametrization, but somehow it includes a collectivity. And one thing that we observe is that if we enhance the effects of the core by selecting the isotropic event, I mean, it overestimated the data. However, the trend is very similar. In isotropic events, PTA gives a larger P2-pi ratio, okay, than in Yeti-like events. So in this sense, both models are producing qualitatively similar results, which seems to agree with the data. Okay, in the future, of course, it will be very important to provide measurements considering a more extreme events, much higher multiplicities, and events in which the particles would be more isotropically distributed, no, in the azimuth. So, so far, as you can see, the spherocity interval is quite wide, no? In the case of isotropic events, it goes from 0.83 up to 1, and in the case of Yeti-like events, go from 0 to 0.6. It's more or less like the 10%, okay, of the spherocity distribution. A similar behavior is observed if we consider the Keon to Pion ratio. So with these slides, as I said, no, it's just to illustrate how the Monte Carlo generators help us to build event classifiers and also help us give us some guidance in order to understand the measurements in terms of the models which are implemented, no, in the Monte Carlo generators. The other example is something that we have recently investigated is related with a new event classifier based on the activity of the event, which is more sensitive to the underlying event. If you plot, actually yesterday I showed some the hadron correlations, and now I hope that you are convinced that if we plot the hadron correlations, if we select a particle with a high Tranberg momentum, and then if we consider angular difference with respect to the rest of the charged particles, then what we will observe is the near side peak, okay, blue, okay, and the way side peak. No, this is just a cartoon, but this signal is above, no, uniform background, which is called underlined event. Okay, so the idea that has been proposed by Peter Skans is to select or to study the particle production as a function of the activity registered here. Because as I said, no, one of the issues with the multiplicity classifier, the Venn classifier that we are using now, is that if we select high multiplicity, then we bias our sample, no, towards harder PP collisions, okay? But what happens if we remove the jet contribution and we only consider the activity in the transverse side, and then study the particle production in both the near side and the way side, but as a function of the particles which are more, which are produced mostly by multiple parton interactions. This is what we have investigated, no, in the last year. This is just a cartoon, no? This figure was taken from the CDF experiment. And now, as you know, that in a PP collision, we have the main partonic scattering, okay, which produces a diejet signal, and we have additional scatterings, which in Pizia, no, is they correspond to the multiparton interactions. In addition, we also have contributions given the interaction with the beam remnant. Okay, so the underlying event is everything, all the particles which are produced by multiparton interactions and the beam remnant. The rest, which belong to the main partonic scattering, correspond to the jet signal. No? And the idea is that we try to reduce that contribution by studying only the region which is more sensitive to MPI. The way in which we investigate this, it follows the approach proposed several years ago by the CDF collaboration, Rickfield, okay, in particular, in which you select the particle with the highest transverse momentum of the event, you correlate with the rest of the particles of your event, all the particles with delta phi smaller than 60 degrees conform the toward side, in which the jet, the fragments of the jets are present, are contributing to this region. And the way side correspond to the associated jet, no? Because we have a scattering, no? And we produce a diejet signal. So all the particles which are which satisfy this condition conform the away side, and the transverse side correspond with the particle production, which is perpendicular to the direction of the leading particle. So the transverse side is, of course, is very sensitive to the underlying event, but it has it has important contributions also from the main partonic scattering, no, in particular, no, from initial and final stellar radiation. So this is something, no, that we cannot avoid. There are ideas, no, that in particular I am exploring, which has to do with doing an additional selection based on the comparison between the multiplicity in the transverse region one and transverse region two. No, we can just split the transverse side into subregions and find the region with the lowest activity, which would be more sensitive to MPI, and the region with the highest activity, in which essentially the signal from the additional jet would be considered. No, but for the time being, we are analyzing the data, considering the two regions, no, transverse one and transverse two together. As I said, this event classifier, which is RT, has been originally proposed by Tim Martins and Peter Skans, in which they are proposing to measure event by event the activity in the transverse region, which is defined in this way. Okay, particles which are in the transverse region with respect to the direction of the leading particle, and this is normalized to the average multiplicity in the same region. In this way, the aim is to reduce at least, no, the way in which we understand this idea is that this would allow us to reduce the jet bias, because we remove the jet peak and the wave side peak, and then just study the activity more sensitive to the MPI. So in his study, what he proposed was to consider a cut on the leading particle, considering only events with leading particles between 10 and 30 GeV. One thing which is important in that particular region is that if we consider the number density, the charged particle production in the transverse side as a function of the leading PT, the models and also data suggest or gives a first fast rise of the activity in the transverse side and then a saturation. Okay, so this is the plateau region where more or less, no, the activity is constant. In that way, we are selecting also the central proton-proton collisions. Okay, so the idea is to study the multiplicity in this particular region and normalize the multiplicity event by the average, no, which is obtained from this type of kind of correlation. The advantage that he discussed in his paper of doing this kind of analysis is that if we consider particles in eta below 2.5 and PT bigger than 0.2 GeV, then one can really enhance the sensitivity to the number of MPIs. In this figure, you see in the horizontal axis the log of RT, and in the vertical axis the number of multiparton interactions. And you see that if you increase the value of RT, then you can achieve events in which the number of MPIs is quite big. Actually, you can reach up to 20 multiparton interactions. I mean, this is just a model, as I said, no, it's just to illustrate that with this type of classifiers, we can enhance the sensitivity to the softer production, no, of the PP collision, no, which in PTA, no, is related with the products of the multiparton interactions. If he plots, for example, the average impact parameter as a function of the log of RT, okay, this is not in Fermi, no? As far as I understand, the value one for this impact parameter, no, which is expressed in terms of the number of MPIs, one means minimum bias, okay? And what we observe is that if we consider events with a very large RT, then the average impact parameter decreases. Therefore, we select, no? If we perform this kind of measurements, we can select central proton-proton collisions in which the MPI activity is significantly higher, no, than in minimum bias proton-proton collisions. So this was something which motivated the collaboration to perform this measurement. And there are some preliminary data on PT spectra of unidentified charged particles. Here you see in the PT distributions going from in black, you can see the minimum bias, sorry, the RT integrated class, okay? In this particular analysis, only events with PT trigger between 5 and 40 GeV were considered. If we increase the multiplicity, no, the highest multiplicity in the transverse side correspond to the red markers, okay? You see that the ratio to the RT integrated gives, for the, at least for the transverse region, a behavior which is very similar to the result that I presented using the standard estimator of middle rapidity. And this is because in this particular measurement, the PT distribution and the multiplicity are determined in the transverse side. So here we still see the autocorrelation, right? If we require a high activity in the transverse side, we are quite sensitive to MPI, but also to hard gluon radiation from hard final state radiation. Okay, And this can explain this behavior at high PT. However, what is interesting is the toward side. The toward side is the region, no, which was isolated from the region in which we determine the multiplicity. If we repeat the same exercise, we measure the PT distribution in the toward region, and we normalize that to the RT integrated class, you see that at low if we increase the multiplicity of the event, okay, we see the gradual increase from 0.15 up to 1 GeV, no, which is associated with the selection in terms of the multiplicity in the underlying event. However, what is nice is that at high PT, it seems that all the data seems to approach to unity. Okay, this measurement is still preliminary. The collaboration is still working on the finalization of the results, but this quantity, this event classifier seems to be quite promising, because if we increase the statistics, if we improve the analysis and reduce the systematic uncertainty, then we will be able to say something about a potential modification or the PT distribution in the jet-like region. So far, it seems that everything will converge to unity. But as I said, no, this is an analysis that is still in progress, and hopefully we will have some results soon. The idea of RT has been implemented not only in proton-proton collisions, but also in proton-lead and lead-lead collisions, okay? What this you see here is the average PT as a function of RT. This result were presented last year in several conferences with Alex collaboration. What you see is that in the near side, if you compare the three colliding system, the three collision systems, the mean PT is the same if you consider events with a very low activity in the transverse region. Here you see the PP point, the P lead point, and the lead point. All the three the measurements agree, because I mean this is something also which is expected. We have a very low activity in proton lead collisions. It's like a PP, or it's a PP like event, and that might explain the same average PT, which is measured in the three collision system. Then the average PT decreases for the three collision system, because here we are dominated by the jet signal. Essentially, we have the jet signal because the RT is very, very small. You only have the jet peak and almost nothing in the transverse side. Okay, it's essentially the jet component. But then if you increase the value of RT, then the activity in the transverse side increases. Okay, and this makes that the average PT becomes smaller in event with a large activity in the transverse side. A similar effect is observed in the wayside, which is also related with the jet signal. The mean PT is essentially the same for the three collision systems, and then we observe a small reduction with increasing RT. And on the other hand, if we study the activity in the transverse side, we observe an increase of the mean PT with increasing the RT value. These measurements are important. I mean, we are working on the finalization of this analysis. These measurements are very important, because now we are happy to see that event generators like PITIA and perhaps Herwig 2, no, within a short time scale, they are able to generate lead-lead collision. This is important, no? Because once the full Monte Carlo generator for lead-lead collision is ready, with all the models, no, that they are putting together in this kind of Monte Carlo, it will be very interesting, no, to compare the lead-lead data with the results from event generators like PITIA, no? It's important because in PITIA, there is no QGP, right? There is only strings, nucleon-nucleon interactions, and it's interesting to see what are the effects that emerge after the inclusion of the different mechanisms, no, in the event generator. Okay, but these measurements are also important, no? Because if now the people from the MC community wants to tune their model using this data, I think that it will be quite useful for them. So far, what I can say is that Pitya and Gantiris doesn't do too bad, no, for the description of this kind of correlation. Okay, we have some comparison, no, between data and Pitya and Gantir for proton lead and lead lead collision. Okay, so these are the two approaches that we have investigated so far, no? The idea of controlling better the selection bias in high multiplicity proton-proton collisions. Okay, one was sphericity, the other is the event classifier RT, which is based on the activity in the transverse region, the most sensitive to the underlying event. But recently, we have started an investigation, no, on the use of new techniques based on machine learning. I mean, the idea is that using, for example, information at particle, final particle level, like multiplicity, event by event, average PT, okay, try to see whether we can build an event classifier in proton-proton collisions very sensitive to multiparton interaction, which of course is related with a selection in terms of the impact parameter. If you check the recent efforts on machine learning, you can see that machine learning now is used in order to extract the impact parameter, the geometry, the information from the initial geometry in heavy ion collisions. There are several publications in lead-lead collisions, and now what we have tried to do in using different Monte Carlo generators was to check whether it would be possible to extract the multiparton interaction activity from the published data. Okay, and this is the approach that we follow. The question is whether we can infer the number of multiparton interaction, which is related with the centrality of the PP collision, from a given set of input variables. And this is a regression problem. It can be considered as a regression problem. And for that, we consider the multivariate regression technique, which is based in boosted decision trees provided in the TNBA framework. Okay. For the analysis, no, that we have done so far, we only consider the PT spectra as a function of multiplicity. Alice has reported the PT distribution for several multiplicity classes and also the multiplicity distribution. Okay, we use that data in order to evaluate the trained models and extract in that way the MPI activity. The input variables that have been used so far are the event by event average PT of charged particles and the multiplicity. And for the systematic studies, we have used other set of input variables, and we have changed the models used for the training of the machine learning algorithms. Okay, look, I do not have more time, so maybe I will skip all this technical discussion, no, related with the test that was done. Maybe let me just concentrate on the final result. So the first idea that we had was to extract the number of MPI, the average number of MPIs as a function of the center of mass energy in proton-proton collision. For that, we checked or we did a Monte Carlo validation. So the target variable is the true number of MPIs provided by the generator, which is the solid line. Okay, and then we train the algorithm using proton-proton collisions at 13 dB, okay, considering the tune 4C. And then what we did was to change the tuning of the Monte Carlo and test the model, the trained algorithm, using a different set of simulations. First with the same tune, but at different center of mass energies, okay? And second, we change the Monte Carlo tune for the training. We use the Monash 2013, the tune 2C. And we also use a completely different event generator like Herwig. And then we try to see whether we could recover, no, the behavior of the average number of MPI as a function of square root s. We also consider a modification in the shape of the number of multiparton interactions, just considering an extreme case, no, and see whether even under that condition, the trained algorithm were able to give us a good estimate of the average number of MPI. Okay, so we assign a systematic uncertainty. So within uncertainty, the different markers represent the estimations that we obtain from machine learning, okay, considering the different variations, and the systematic error is shown in the gray boxes. We can recover within uncertainty the energy dependence, going from the RIC energies up to the LHC energies. Also, we check whether if we remove, for example, if we change the model used to tune the in order to train the algorithm, whether we could still recover the behavior of the average number of MPI as a function of multiplicity of square root s. And actually we see that under this variation, the systematic uncertainty covers very well this variation. We check the model dependence, and we applied the same technique to simulations in which the multiparton interactions were not activated. And in this case, at least within uncertainties, without color reconnection, if we remove color reconnection from the simulation which we used to test the model, we could recover, no, something which is closer to unity. No? So I mean, the method seems to work well. We also test this considering the extraction of MPIs as a function of multiplicity. We perform several variations for the training, changing the tune of the Monte Carlo used for the tune used for the training, and also the model. We consider these three tunes of PTIA, and we consider Herwig simulations. And within uncertainties, we could recover, no, the behavior of the number of MPIs as a function of multiplicity. Okay, so the method seems to work well. And now let me briefly discuss the results. Using the published data from Malise, we could extract this information, okay? And we obtain these values, okay, for PP collisions at 5, 7, and 13 TeV. Within uncertainty, we observe that the average number of MPI was above one, suggesting or giving more additional evidence of the presence of MPI in proton-proton collisions at the LHC energies. And in addition, we extract the MPI as a function of multiplicity for the three centers of mass energies, and we observe a gradual increase of the MPI and then a deviation at higher multiplicities. This behavior has been observed in previous measurements in ALICE, for example. In ALICE in 2013, an analysis which consists on the measurement of the so-called interrelated seeds, which is very sensitive to the number of semi-hard scattering, it was found that if we consider PP collisions at 0.9 to 0.76 dB and 7 dB, then the activity, the number of uncorrelated seeds increase linearly with multiplicity, and then they deviate at higher multiplicity. Using machine learning and the available data, we could find something very similar. Okay, so I mean, I didn't have enough time, but maybe I can just say that it seems that it's possible to do this kind of analysis. At least this is what the simulations suggest. No? We perform the Monte Carlo validation. And the second encouraging result is the consistency between the extracted number of MPIs as a function of multiplicity, the consistency of the results obtained using machine learning and those obtained from the MPI dedicated analysis of the ALICE collaboration, okay? This is good, no? Because actually what one can do then, if we would have a trained model, which would allow us to extract the MPI activity considering observables with final charged particles, okay? Then one can define something very similar to the nuclear modification factor, no? That yesterday I discussed with you, in which you remember that the PT distribution is measured in that case in AA collision and is normalized to the number of binary nucleon interactions. So if one could extract the number of MPI from the data, then one can define this ratio and then plot the ratio of the PT distribution in event with a large number of MPI. And this can be scaled to the average number of MPI for that particular event class, okay? And then this spectrum could be compared with the same, a similar quantity, but in minimum bias proton-proton collisions, okay? And what we expect to see based on PTA simulation, for example, if we plot this RPP, okay, is that if you increase the number of MPIs and plot a ratio of the PT distribution event with 50 MPI with respect to minimum bias proton-proton collision, then we observe the development of a small bump at intermediate PT, which decreases when we reduce the number of MPIs and is almost flat the ratio when we consider a lower number of MPIs. If we remove color recognition, then we don't see this behavior, okay? I have to say that this effect has never been seen in BP data. In PP data, I have shown that the ratio of high multiplicity to minimum bias gives a fast rise of the ratio at high PT, even in the case of the multiplicity measured in the forward V0 detector. We have never seen such a behavior in the data, okay? Because there, using the existing multiplicity classifier, we have a strong selection biases, okay? But now if one would really build a classifier very sensitive to MPI, one would expect to see this kind of effects, which is actually very similar to the so-called Cronin-like peak, which is observed in proton-led collisions, okay? So what is nice from the regression analysis, at least it is what the simulation does, is that if we apply regression, at least from the simulation, we can see that if we plot the same ratio as a function of the number of MPI obtained from regression, then, I mean, qualitatively, one can see more or less the same behavior. This is something, no, that, we will try to investigate on the data. And I think that, with the new upgrades of the experiment, perhaps we would be able to improve this classifier, no, with a strong sensitivity to the multiple pattern interactions. Okay, so this is all from my side. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Antonio. Appreciate it. And again, we will have time this evening for more discussion and questions. And I've put I've collected the questions on the under the recitation links. You can find that there. So, thank Antonio again. We'll take a short break, and at the half hour in about 25 minutes, we will start the tutorials and they will be on GatherTown. So have a good break and we'll see you in about 25 minutes for the tutorials. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Good. Appreciate it. And again, thank you. I know it's early in the morning, but I appreciate the help. So,
okay.
All right. Take care. We'll see you.
Bye. Bye.